Barbara, für diese sehr schöne Begrüßung und Einleitung, die ja auch schon sehr viel Licht darauf geworfen hat, worum es hier heute gehen soll. Auch ich danke Ihnen allen, dass Sie heute hierher gekommen sind und würde die Teilnehmer des ersten Podiums gerne bitten, sich zu mir zu gesellen. Wir haben hier zwei Leute, die Input geben werden. Das handelt sich hier zum einen um Herrn Francesc Vendrell, der als erster UN-Vertreter in Afghanistan 2000 und 2001 war, danach als Sondergesandter der Europäischen Union in Afghanistan bis 2008 war, also wirklich eine lange Zeit in Afghanistan verbracht hat. Und wir haben aus Afghanistan ebenfalls für einen Input Herrn Amrullah Saleh, der vorherige Direktor des Nationalen Direktorats für Sicherheit in Afghanistan ist. Wir werden mit diesen beiden Herren beginnen, die jeweils einen etwa 10-minütigen Input geben werden. Dann befinden sich auf dem Podium noch Frau Shinkal Karokhel, eine Parlamentarierin aus Afghanistan, die auch schon in der ersten Legislaturperiode Beachtliches im Parlament Afghanistans geleistet hat. Wir haben ebenfalls einen Parlamentarier aus Deutschland hinzugebeten, Herrn Tom Königs, den manche von Ihnen sicherlich auch noch in Erinnerung haben, aus seiner Zeit bei der UNAMA in Afghanistan als deren Sondergesandter. Und wir haben ebenfalls hier Herrn Thomas Ruttig, Co-Direktor des Afghan Analyst Networks. Diese drei Herren und Damen würden wir nach dem Input von Herrn Vendrell und Herrn Saleh bitten, zu kommentieren, auch ihre eigenen Vorstellungen hier hinzuzufügen. Thematisch geht es um die Entwicklung in Afghanistan seit 2001. Es soll also eine Art kurzer Rückblick stattfinden. Es geht aber natürlich ganz wesentlich darum, wo stehen wir heute und auch um einen Ausblick in die Zukunft. Denn ich denke, Einigkeit besteht weithin darüber, dass in Afghanistan vieles nicht erreicht wurde von dem, was eingangs von außen versprochen und von innen erhofft wurde, dass viele Erwartungen sich nicht erfüllt haben und dass in vielerlei Hinsicht die Lage nicht etwa nur langsam besser geworden ist, sondern dass es ganz im Gegenteil so ist, dass spätestens seit 2006 auch eine Verschlechterung der Lage in vielerlei Hinsicht stattgefunden hat. Und wir wollen versuchen, mit den anwesenden Experten hier einen Blick darauf zu werfen, warum das so laufen konnte, was die Gründe sind und wer hier vielleicht an welcher Stelle andere Weichen hätte stellen können oder eben auch heute noch andere Weichen stellen kann. Nach der ersten Runde würden wir auch das Podium öffnen, damit Sie Ihre Fragen stellen können, damit Sie mit dem Podium in eine Diskussion treten können. Ich sehe das große Interesse repräsentiert in der Vielzahl der Anwesenden. Sicherlich wird die Zeit auch hier wieder nicht ausreichen, deswegen würde ich schon jetzt alle Anwesenden auf dem Podium bitten, sich relativ dicht an die Zeitvorgaben zu halten und auch das Publikum bitten, ihre Fragen und Anmerkungen relativ präzise zu formulieren. Wer enttäuscht darüber sein sollte, dass er vielleicht nicht zu Wort kommt oder nicht so ausgiebig, wie er oder sie sich das vorgestellt hat, möge bitte danach nicht zähneknirschend den Raum verlassen, sondern wir haben auch, wie Sie dem Programm entnehmen können, relativ großzügige Pausen eingeplant. Nutzen Sie die Gelegenheit, auch hier dann den Austausch mit den Anwesenden zu suchen. An dieser Stelle würde ich Sie bitten, zu mir aufs Podium zu kommen. Herrn Vendrell, ich würde Sie auch direkt bitten, hier jetzt zu übernehmen. Thomas Shinkal, would you also mind already coming up?
Good morning. It's a pleasure to be in Berlin and to have been invited by the Heinrich Berlin Foundation. And I will try to be as short as possible, even if our predecessors have perhaps been a bit longer than we are. But let me divide and my presentation into three. One is what has been achieved, what has actually failed, and what can we do in the coming years. Let me quickly say that there have been achievements over the past 10 years. It's only natural. I think amongst these major accomplishments, and I just mentioned very few, we have representative political institutions in Afghanistan, even if they are weak and flawed. There is greater respect for human rights than probably at any other time in the history of Afghanistan, particularly in Kabul. Less so, I think, in other places, although much more needs to be done. We have, and I don't say that because they are present here, we have an Afghanistan Independent Human Rights Commission that is a model for many developing countries, truly independent, truly active. We have improved rights for women, including a quarter of the seats in parliament, access to education, and access to employment, the latter which was being virtually impossible under the Taliban. We have new civil society institutions, some of them here, even if I have to also say they are still weak, understandably. There is improved health, access to health, and particularly to education, particularly at the primary level. There is improved infrastructure, physical infrastructure in the country, and there are Afghan national security institutions, even if they are still far from perfect, although I have to say that foreigners have tended to emphasize numbers over quality. What were the mistakes made over the past 10 years? Well, first of all, in politics and in diplomacy, the windows of opportunity are very narrow. You really have to seize them when they come. Now, we had the window of opportunity open on September 11th, 2001. In a way, it partly closed when the Northern Alliance took over Kabul. There was a possibility in late September, early October, to have convened what became the Petersburg Conference earlier, before there were facts on the ground. And we in the UN favored very much this. We were not listened to, and the decision to finally convene the Bonn Conference took place after the Northern Alliance had taken over two-thirds of the country. And therefore, we were back to a situation that had bedeviled other attempts to resolve to normalize the country, because we had facts on the ground that had to be taken into account. The result was an underrepresentation of Pashtuns in the government and in official positions. Two, it meant that from the very beginning, ministries, governorships, police chiefs were given to ill-qualified people, many of whom were notorious in Afghanistan for the violations of human rights, for the anarchy and bad governance that had occurred between 92 and 96, thus paving the way to the arrival of the Taliban in 96. The decision to go for a UN light footprint was, in my view, a mistake. And it's something I want to particularly remind our Afghan colleagues. The lesser the UN representation, the more likely it is that other foreign powers will intervene heavily. And that, of course, is what actually happened in Afghanistan. There was really no serious DDR, demobilization, disarmament and reintegration, or disbandment of illegal armed groups. And neither the US nor NATO took the slightest interest in ensuring that the government of Afghanistan would have the monopoly on the means of violence. The same applied to the first step in transitional justice, which was a serious vetting process. There was no serious vetting process, and NATO and the US made it clear that if there were problems in challenging some of these of warlords or people who were not who should have been vetted, they made it clear they would not intervene to support the government. New militias have been created over the past few years, particularly over the last 2 years. Militias are a danger to the stability of Afghanistan in the future. We also had an incredible blindness towards Pakistan, particularly until 2007. Another problem was that attention was soon diverted to Iraq, so that Afghanistan became a second area of interest, not the main one. There was too much of a focus on personalities. If we could just find, some people thought, the right person, that's all we need. Now, you cannot expect miracle men or women. You need teams, you need institutions. And that we failed to do. There was excessive optimism on the part of governments. They wanted to hear good news, when in fact there were many grounds for worrying that things were not going the right way from the very beginning. There has been a lack of clear strategy and objectives by the international community, and I might also add to some degree a lack of a strategy by the Afghan government. It's not clear to the Afghan people, or indeed to the foreign public, to the Western public, why are we in Afghanistan? Some days we say we want to help the Afghans rebuild the country. The following day, or by the day I probably mean a few months later, no, we are only in Afghanistan to defeat terrorism. We are not into nation building. We are not there to get girls into school. We're just there to disrupt the Taliban and to kill, basically, Al-Qaeda. Not enough was done to ensure free and credible presidential or parliamentary elections, but particularly in the case of the presidential elections, so that there is a lack of credibility and an element of delegitimization of political institutions. I'm afraid that we also failed to encourage and promote political parties not linked to armed groups. There was the so-called COIN, the counterinsurgency strategy has lacked a political base. It has only a military leg. It has no political, no effort has been made to ensure that the government that is in Afghanistan has support, that it has is being perceived by the Afghans as worth fighting for. Now, what are the prospects for the future? I think, let's be entirely honest. What many Afghans and what some of us hoped to achieve in 2001 isn't going to happen. Now, we will have to scale down our expectations. At the same time, it is clear that we should not allow Afghanistan to sink into a quagmire or to sink into renewed civil conflict or civil war. So here are the steps, in my view, would be required to ensure a minimum of stability and a minimum agreement that would be accepted by the Afghans, which is, after all, the most important aspect. One, I think one needs to build a genuine political consensus amongst the political class in Afghanistan. not a real genuine one, and together with civil society on possible areas where there could be some concessions to the Taliban, but also where the red lines should be. I think it's important that the US and the government of Afghanistan should attempt to speak in unison with the and not in total, and therefore achieving that is not going to be easy. It's important also to ensure that the Taliban negotiators are the genuine representatives of the Taliban. And perhaps the opening of a Taliban liaison office abroad might help the Taliban to be more independent from any other outside power. I think it's essential to any dialogue with the Taliban to be properly structured. The assassination of Professor Rabbani, which was of course a tragedy, pointed out clearly that if you don't have a properly structured dialogue, both sides of the torch run a danger. The danger cost the life of President Rabbani. It would easily also have cost the lives at some other point of some Taliban. You need, therefore, to have this structured torch held abroad. It's essential to reach an understanding with the key neighbors of Afghanistan about the parameters for a political settlement. And that you have to do not on the basis of regional conferences, but first bilaterally, by talking to each country quietly and reaching and finding out what the genuine national interests are and how to make them compatible with each other. We need to establish a support network, both inside Afghanistan and outside, governments, parliamentarians, NGOs, to ensure that the gains on women's rights, political freedoms, and other gains are not are preserved and not given away in a negotiation. We will need eventually a proper verification mechanism, without which any agreement will probably come to very little. And finally, I believe that a third-party facilitator, and I still think that with all its faults, the UN is the best place organization, you need a third-party facilitator enjoying the trust of Afghans, the US, and the neighbors to put all of this rather complicated network together. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Vendran. Mr. Amrullah Saleh, could you please share your ideas with us?
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I want to first thank the management of HBS for inviting me to speak. Before going to my very brief presentation, I want to comment on what the first speaker said about the roots of the problem in my country. That's unfortunately very easy simplification of the problem that we are all guilty for creating it. Afghanistan's problem, yes, there is ethnic dynamics, but it's not purely ethnic. To say Pashtuns are underrepresented, it's basically buying the narrative of Pakistani dictator Musharraf, who justified assistance to a proxy group under the title of helping an ethnic group in my country. So if the international community is failing, the failure should not be blamed on the poor Afghans, whether they are Pashtuns or non-Pashtuns. Now to my presentation. I want to focus on the current strength of the ANSF, the Afghan National Security Forces, the political situation, and the few ways we have forward. The ANSF, the National Security Forces of Afghanistan, will have the pivotal and central role to play today in 2014 and beyond. But unfortunately, the size of the ANSF was not in accord with the vision of the Afghan leadership. It is in accord with the growing strength of the Taliban, and it is in accord with the growing assistance of the Pakistani government for the insurgency. I remember clearly we, the Afghans, insisting time and again that we should be allowed to have an army of nearly 100,000 men. But it was rejected on the grounds that Afghanistan is a poor country, it cannot sustain that size of a force. And the definition and the mandate of the Afghan army was defined as a force to allow the president of the country to have maneuvers, to act in the times of national calamity like floods or earthquakes, and also to be a force for helping the government resolve local disputes over pasture, water, women, whatever. It was never defined a force to protect the territorial integrity of Afghanistan or fight a proxy war. As the Pakistani assistance for Taliban continued and it grew in size, and the Taliban re-emerged as a strategic threat to the national security of Afghanistan, ANSF size was adjusted accordingly. So it's a fear-based institution, not a vision-based institution. The Afghan National Army, the key element in the National Security Forces of Afghanistan, is obviously a pride for all of the Afghans. And it is one single achievement we all can point out over the past 10 years. But I want to do a very brief macro analysis of that institution and see whether it can stand beyond 2014 with heavily subsidy and assistance from the West to keep the Taliban at bay. And I count some of the problems which hinder the capability of the Afghan National Army to be an effective fighting force. A, the army lacks secucrats. You hardly find people in the National Army who are born from the institution. You find many people who are political appointees from this faction or that faction, this individual or that individual, and they have occupied senior positions. Why? Because that is the style of President Karzai's leadership, to encourage patronage in every area. Two, massive politics of patronage and kinship, as I said, as the style of the current government of Afghanistan, the price will be paid both by Afghans and by you because you are partly financing the Afghan National Security Forces. It's a highly unsustainable force financially. As I said, the size of the force is in reaction to the strength and the growing number of the attacks by the Taliban, not based on the vision of the Afghan leadership. So in 2014, as you decrease the number of foreign troops, you have an unsustainable Afghan force, and the Taliban do not agree to negotiate, and they keep protracting the fighting. Will the strategy be to protract the size of the Afghan security forces, or just assign them to provide security for key strategic installations? Will we play according to the script of the Taliban, protract the fighting, or we confine ourselves to cities, paved roads, and government buildings, and cede territory to the insurgency? These are some of the questions I will briefly come back and answer. If the Taliban agree to negotiate, what will be the fate and future of the ANSF? Will we say then Afghanistan is a poor country, it doesn't need this size of a force, let us DDR the Afghan National Army, the Afghan police, and create civilian jobs for them? What is the vision? The Afghans have very little say in these key and strategic questions. Now, the current ANSF, the Afghan National Security Forces, in 2014 will not be able to keep the Taliban at bay and provide security for reconstruction, economic development, and governance. Not necessarily because the Taliban outnumber ANSF, not that the quality of Taliban weapons is better than the ANSF, not that their logistic system is better. There are a number of facts which hinder the capability of the ANSF. Some of them I just mentioned. The other one is a force must fight for a political vision. The rear has to be very clear and clean. They have to fight for a philosophy. If that philosophy and politics is blurred and it is full of corruption and it is divided, then the utility of force decreases and it does not increase. So if we require the ANSF to be an effective fighting force and law enforcement force, then we have to cleanse Kabul. Cleanse it of corruption, cleanse it of manipulation, and provide a vision and a narrative for all Afghans so they can see a brighter future. In that case, the ANSF will not fight for money only, but they will fight for something much more and bigger than financial incentive. If not, the current ANSF, with the current way of governance without reform, they will not be able to create a breakthrough, and the continuation of the current situation, the status quo, I call it muddle through. It will not bring a breakthrough in the situation. With that, I am going to the last part of my presentation. Then if the ANSF, with the massive assistance of NATO that is today, with the policy of surge escalation, are not able to create a breakthrough. The surge was not able to end the very basic and fundamental question, the assistance of Pakistan for insurgency. How can a policy of de-escalation, de-surge, decrease in attention, decrease in resources, will give us hope that in 2014 there will be a weaker Taliban, there will be a nicer Pakistan, there will be a cleaner Afghan politics? What gives us that confidence? And I am going to paint scenarios. Scenario one, what I called scenario muddle through, is status quo. We are in a stalemate today. All of us achieve tactical victories, whether it is civil society, ANSF, NATO. But can we create a breakthrough in the situation? No. Why we can't create a breakthrough in the situation? At the macro level, Pakistan is hopeful of winning strategically. They believe NATO is winning tactically. NATO is killing mid-level commanders, NATO is killing Taliban expendables, NATO is doing this thing or that thing, but NATO is unable to dry down the source of support for the Taliban, to attack the Taliban leadership, to kill the very philosophy which has brought the Taliban into existence, to decouple it with Al-Qaeda, and to have a strategy for Islamic extremism and militancy. So, if this scenario continues, what does it mean? It means Afghanistan will be a liability, not a partner. You will have to provide massive amount of subsidization and assistance to keep a system which is not able to create breakthrough and is muddling through, and you have to pay for it to civil society, for its security forces, for its political development, but yet the size of the land controlled by the state is daily shrinking, not increasing. Scenario 2. Taliban agreed to hold talks. Let's not call that political process. My information is, if we apply more pressure on the Taliban, if truly Pakistanis see there is no way out of this tunnel, if truly they see that, they are not seeing it today, they may agree to become militant political, similar to Lebanese Hezbollah, have a constituency, source of funding, its own army, yet enter into some type of arrangement with Kabul. If the international community ever agreed to that type of arrangement, it will be fragmentation of authority in the beginning, fragmentation of the country in the second stage. Calling for the Taliban to open up an office in Turkey or in Qatar or elsewhere is the beginning of disaster. We should not weaken the very state which has been created with the blood and treasure of the West and with the blood and treasure of the Afghans. Let that state get into talks and negotiations with the Taliban. You should not internationalize the cause of a terrorist proxy group by bringing them outside their sanctuaries. Let us finish them in their sanctuaries. Now, they may at one stage come and offer and say, give us the east, give us the south, we enter into ceasefire with Kabul, but we will have a capability of delivering services, but we will not lay down our arms. That scenario is minimum what the Pakistanis want, to control their own borders with a proxy group, to evict India and diminish its access and influence in South and Eastern Afghanistan, and to maintain a proxy which can be dehibernated and activated any moment Islamabad and Rawalpindi wishes to pressure Kabul. Scenario 3, what I call dream scenario, the best scenario that we need to pursue. Let us take into consideration that Pakistan will remain as deceptive as it is today. Let us think that Taliban will remain resilient as they are today. What is there that we can do to create breakthrough, reform? Let us strengthen the Afghan state. The Afghan state is judiciary, it is parliament, it is executive. Let us not be personal-centric. This name or that name, if not Karzai, who? That is a wrong question. Let us open up the space for the Afghan politics to mature and grow. Now, what do I mean exactly by reform? There will come 2014. We cannot stop the time. And when 2014 comes, instead of talking about lost opportunities with nostalgia as we do today, we should be prepared to manage the crisis then. In 2014, the Western capitals will have two types of statements ready to be issued. Statement one, we endorsed the elections. It was fair, free, and the Afghans participated. We welcome the result. We congratulate the Afghan people. That is one scenario. You will have a partner sitting in Kabul, not a liability. The other scenario is all of the Western capitals issue a statement condemning the massive fraud and embezzlement in the elections. What do you do then? You go back to square one, square zero, and redo the election. Is there something called rewind button for time? No. So if you want to issue the first statement, let us now work hard to bring reform. It will be a shame for Afghanistan and for all of us collectively if in 2014 the Chief Justice for resolving the dispute in the Afghan elections will be again John Kerry, not the Afghan Chief Justice, not the Afghan Attorney General. So we need to bring reform in the Independent Elections Commission, in the justice sector, and we have to respect the Afghan parliament. The Afghan parliament has been bypassed, marginalized, and its prestige and standing in the Afghan society has been shattered very badly. Without these reforms, I am not saying I am against the notion suggesting that with 2014 Afghan institutions will crumble and we will sink into civil war. No. With the amount of assistance we will still get in 2014, the Afghan state will be richer than the insurgency. There will be more people willing to be with the state than with the resource-hit insurgents. But it will not create breakthrough. The other area which we badly, badly need reform is in the area of economy, Ministry of Finance, the corruptest institution in Afghanistan. Why we are not able to tax our cities? Buildings, mushrooms in Afghanistan, ask them, have they ever paid tax? No. Yes, the Afghan revenue has increased from $500 million 10 years ago or 5 years ago to 1.5. Now, for those of you who know economics, in terms of real dollars, it is the same thing. For Afghanistan, to be able to sustain part of it is expenses, we have to focus on the Ministry of Finance. We have to expand our tax base. We are far, far richer than the time of the king, but the machinery for tax collection during those days was much disciplined and better than today, despite not having the number of educated people we have today in Afghanistan. That area is neglected. Let's not be war-centric. Let's not be transition-centric. Let us use this opportunity, unlike September to October 2001, we have 3 years, a span of 3 years in front of us to bring reform. Else, the other scenario will not be as optimistic as we all wish. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Amrullah Saleh, for this very interesting presentation. I now would first like Mishinka Karkhil, would you please share your ideas for like 5 minutes?
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Good morning, everybody. And thanks, HBS, for providing such opportunity to speak on behalf of Afghan and for Afghanistan. After speeches of two gentlemen from Afghanistan and from international community, and brief comments or objection or agree or disagreement of mine, first point which I would really focus on it, I am absolutely agree with Mr. Vendral not supporting Parvez Musharraf mentality from where the beginning of Taliban has been started was really underrepresentative of Pashtuns and neglecting a big number of political parties or ideology and throw them out of Afghanistan. And arrest and torture each Afghan with long beard and big turban and consider him as a Talib or terrorist was the biggest mistake. It was not only happened by Afghan government or the security system, plus international forces, especially Americans, and put each Afghan even till now and consider him, each Pashtun consider him as a Talib or Islamic extremist, which was not fair. So what happened? Our neighboring countries, especially those group who are promoting and supporting terrorism and extremism in the region, it was a good excuse for them to how to work with these people, how to support them and form them and also use them against the stability of Afghanistan. Those who are representing in the government of Afghanistan were not in such a position which was the other ethnic group represent. They were so vulnerable and have no clear authority or clear protection, so how they can raise or object with something to do. Another mistake which what happened, all the big contracts were given to those warlords was really people of Afghanistan really neglect them during the civil war. Almost 100,000 people were killed in Kabul, but nobody take the responsibility. Those groups, some of these people were involved, got a big contract. Now they are not only political mafia, but also they become the economic mafia of the country. So this was another. So other people, like the majority of Pashtun, were not given such opportunity to also have got like a big contracts and become all, the balance come in a power or in a economic situation. Another thing, what happened in Afghanistan to increase the insurgency was impunity. It's not only the Taliban. Those who exist inside the system, they are also more dangerous than the actual Taliban outside the system, because they are biting the system internally. That's what we are facing, very fragile state in Afghanistan. So because of the crime they did it, and they don't want to be responsible for that, so they are doing worse than what the Taliban doing nowadays. Lack of accountability. So there is no proper system. They should be accountable what they are doing. We have a system, because there is no system of check and balance. We have a constitution how to bring president to impeachment, but we did not complete the mechanism how to do that. So there is no accountability, maybe intentionally or unintentionally. I hope my English is correct, because I'm not very perfect English speaker. Creation of a lot of democratic institutions in the country, Human Rights Commission, independent election commissions, or the commission for appointing high-rank Afghan in a system, or so many other institutions. But all of these institutions are not properly functioning, because they are really underutilized. Or the government somehow try to influence and control them, or to keep them very much depending rather than to be supported or to be promoted to independency. So this is another mistakes or what happened in Afghanistan. So this all good and very fundamental institution to promote transparency and democracy in Afghanistan was really underutilized. Under that, international community, rather than to invest and support the government, especially the security system, but they try to build parallel system like supporting or creating security company in Afghanistan. And we have lots of proof or document that most of people were involved in these big companies. They were involved in human trafficking, drug trafficking, lots of other illegal business. So they become another problem for the safety and security people of Afghanistan. Also, like Mr. Windrell said, there was no unified mission or strategy in Afghanistan. Everybody wants to deal with the issue of Afghanistan separately. And everybody was willing, and they were thinking about the way they thought for Afghanistan, and they thought it's the priority of Afghanistan. They never think how to share this and invest based on Afghanistan priority, especially education. See what's happening in Afghanistan. We have less than 20% of literate women in Afghanistan. Another problem was the massive or biggest interference of two neighborhoods, Pakistan and Iran. So I remember with Mr. Saleh was our the intelligence service head, and most of the time he was called to come to the parliament. And one of the complaints which he also had it was international community never trust what we were sharing with them. And they thought there's no interference, or Pakistani, some of the Pakistani guru from ISI or their military are not involved, till they killed Osama bin Laden in military compound. So that's why so many proof was available, but nobody was trusting the Afghan system or the Afghan government how to control all this interference from the beginning.
Thank you, Shinkai.
And you have one more minute. How to improve the situation? A few recommendations which I have it. That one of them, I think, is the good governance. How to provide very quality service in Afghanistan, how to do appointment based on merit, but not about dealing or ethnic participation, because qualification should be the merit for appointment. Utilization of the democratic institute, the country to function very well, to how to support and how to strengthening the system. Rule of law is important. Forming political parties in the country, but not only stick with a few political parties which has their own military background. And also, how to deal with the Taliban negotiation. I think we need a third party, but not those who are already in conflict with Taliban, to bring them again and form High Peace Council. That will not work. But we need the people who are not involved in 3 decades of war in some party or in a government, and by the support of international community to deal with this issue, and especially the Security Council is very much important to pressure, especially how to convince or prepare the two neighbors to really properly contribute and help. Otherwise, without Pakistan agreement or helping Pakistan, we will got another suicide attacker to attack the people of Afghanistan. And also, I hope international community start to, after 10 years, start to invest on the priority of Afghans, especially on education. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Shinkai. Tom Kunis, could I kindly ask you to follow your parliamentary colleague?
I would like to make one point first, which I think was very convincing in the intervention of my dear colleague Frances Vendrell, but also of Amrullah Saleh. I've cooperated with for a long time and very positively. We have to believe in Afghanistan in institutions, even if these institutions for the time being are weak. One institution we have never believed in from the international community, this was Parliament. Now, as a parliamentarian, I may say the attention parliamentarians in our country and the institution of the Parliament gets from all sides, from international and national, is different to the one of Afghanistan. The crisis between the president and the Parliament is always resolved by winning of the president. And none of the international community had an explicit policy to make the parliamentarians successful. On the provincial level, where the provincial council haven't even a constitution or a rule of working, everybody only speaks with the governor, never speaks with the parliamentarians, the provincial council. On the level of the national parliament, you have a lot of goodwill from all sorts of actors for training the parliamentarians. But to address the parliament as the source of power, this is completely absent. One second remark I would like to make on the basis of the intervention. We have all seen that the focus of attention has been derailed in the very moment the US started the Iraqi war. This was a change, a shift of attention, of public attention in the United States, in the civil society of the United States, and in the international community as a whole, abroad from Afghanistan. We have to prevent that in 2014 the same happens with us again, that the attention derails or lowers because of the reduced presence of the military, because even our discourse, especially here in the country, Germany, in the other countries, is a very military focused vision, view of the situation. Let me say one third. There will not be peace in Afghanistan without active participation and goodwill from the side of Pakistan. Amrullah Saleh always has pronounced this in a rather confrontative way. I would put it in a more diplomatic point. There is a progress that we now have the same department in the Foreign Office dealing with Afghanistan and Pakistan, that we have a representative who is called Afghanistan-Pakistan, that we have a contact group which is focused on both. This is not enough. We have the region, and we have regional powers who have to be involved and have to be engaged in an active interest into peace in Afghanistan. Ahmed Rashid has said this over and over again. I think this is a major focus. And before any negotiations for peace with the Taliban can be reasonably organized, in a sense, and I agree very much to Frances Van Gell, what has to be done to organize it, it has to be made sure that Pakistan and Iran agree and are informed and support this. These are three points I think we could agree upon, and we have to focus on. I do hope that this will be a focus of the Bonn conference. A last point, only Frances Van Gell mentioned, you will think it's a commercial, but I do think that the organization which could and should integrate all these very distinct powers in the region can only be United Nations.
Thank you, Tom Koenigs. Thomas Ruttig, would you kindly jump in?
Thank you very much. I have a couple of footnotes. The first footnotes are footnotes to footnotes. On the Afghan National Security Force, or the army and the police, in the beginning, the international community was against having these oversized, in those days, or for those days, oversized forces, because people then in the government were remobilizing fighters into the army just to make sure that money comes flowing, and on the basis of how many people are there. And we know that there were probably a couple of 10,000 shadow soldiers who only existed in the payment lists of certain military units, and that made a lot of people who are still in government very rich. That's why I also disagree with the use of the word nostalgia when we talk about what happened in Afghanistan in the beginning of the past 10 years. I think we will never be able to understand what has been done and what needs to be done without tackling those years. And I think it's one of the weaknesses of the international community, but also sometimes of Afghan friends and colleagues, that they don't want to see some of these things because they are not very favorable for themselves. Diplomats cannot be blamed because they have a turnover rate of, I don't know, 1 year or 2 years, but the Afghans have been there all the way, so they actually should look into these things. And that also has to do with the second footnote about Pashtuns and non-Pashtuns and whatever. I mean, from an analytical point of view, the first governments in Afghanistan were different from now. Now I also would not say that Pashtuns are underrepresented, but in the beginning, the power ministries, as the Russians would call it, were clearly in the hand of non-Pashtun factions, and that made a lot of people in the Pashtun areas angry. Although I agree that the ethnic factor is important, but it's not everything, and we should not always over-ethnicize. And that's where I'm really with the dream scenario Amrullah Saleh here presented. It's not about ethnicity, it's about good people governing. But the thing is, and that also has been mentioned, that institutions are weak. It has also been mentioned that there is no political middle ground. And that's exactly, this political middle ground was closed down by a very negative cooperation between the international community, who just wanted to concentrate, as Frances said, in this very diplomatic way on a certain person, that was President Karzai. In the beginning, he was made the president, and everything was done that he was elected time and again, without too many people who were able to challenge him. And everyone, including international partners, only wanted to work with the president and forgot that there's something like other political forces in Afghanistan, amongst them also amongst Pashtuns, and that there is civil society. And these forces, who also could have been and hopefully still can be stabilizing factors about an Islamicization, as I would call it, in Afghanistan, takeover of the Taliban or takeover by some other factions or in a combined way or separate from each other, that has been neglected to work with them. Another factor I want to mention is this famous talking to the Taliban, how and about what and whatever. I personally think that calling the Taliban a terrorist or reducing the Taliban to being a terrorist proxy group is as wrong as to say that the Taliban are the representatives of the Pashtuns, because there is no middle political space in Afghanistan, and particularly amongst the Pashtuns, there are no other political forces Pashtuns can identify with. And I think this is something which needs to be done and also promoted by international actors in the coming 2 years. It has, this political space in the middle has been is filling up a little bit now. We have the new party. I don't want to make commercials here, but Rights and Justice Party. We also have Mr. Saleh's movement, who try to be third forces, and I think that's a good development, but it's very much only in the beginning. Back to the dream scenario, reform, taxing of Afghans, yes, but I will only believe in the willingness to reform by all political forces in Afghanistan when I see that also their own allies of those people who demand it, like what Mr. Saleh just did, really are presented with a tax bill. We all know that the economic sector in Afghanistan is the only sector which is not ethnicized. There are Pashtuns, but non-Pashtuns are cooperating very well, and it's actually the power brokers from all factions, Pashtuns and non-Pashtuns, who don't tax. So probably everyone should start cleaning a little bit in his own house, and then they can also talk about other people not complying with these things. I'm sorry when I'm a little bit undiplomatic, but I think Afghanistan's situation is dire enough. Last point on talking to the Taliban also, we should not, and that's probably a very bold statement, we should not take the assassination of Ustad Rabbani, which was a tragedy, as a complete no of the Taliban movement, which many people claim is very broad and diversified, to a political process or talks. I also agree that talking with the Taliban is not to be equaled with the political process. It's only a very, it's an important but small part of it. We have seen signs, not least by those talks which have also been fostered by the German government with representatives of the Taliban leader Mullah Omar, that there are people who still want to talk. And we all know from other peace processes that it's very easy to derail a peace process. You just need, excuse my words, a couple of nutters who are decided to go and derail it. And that's actually what probably has happened with the assassination of Mr. Rabbani. We also need to know that all those who afterwards said, okay, you know, that's a sign that the Taliban don't want to talk, it's hopeless and whatever, are those who also were against talking to the Taliban before. I think we really have to be very simplistic here. We have watched for 10 years how a military solution in Afghanistan has been tried against the Taliban. It has not worked. Mr. Saleh knows probably most about that from amongst all of us, and he has illustrated that very vividly. There's also no guarantee that the political process or political solution will work, but we have to try it. And it's not good enough to do that, what you call it, putting labels on people and saying these are just proxies of Pakistan or whatever. Yes, to a large extent, they're dependent from Pakistan. They are sometimes doing what the Pakistanis want, but it's not what the whole Taliban movement stands for. And I've been working myself in the south of Afghanistan. I know that area a little bit. And there are people down there who are Taliban because they, and here I come back to the one of the first factors I was mentioning, that they just don't have any place else to go to when they cannot work with the government or are even not allowed to work with the government, when they're persecuted. When people in the government call the U.S. Special Forces, that's the Taliban sympathizers who do a night raid on his house, and that very often happens without asking too many questions. And that has estranged a lot of people from this government, who were, including former Taliban, who wanted to work in the first years with it, and who have been actually driven into the mountains. So I hope with all outrage about the killing of Ustad Rabbani, which I share absolutely, that we don't forget that we need to think a little bit politically about these things and look for a peaceful solution. Because if that muddling through scenario, a continuation of the status quo, is really followed up, that might look from perspective of Western governments as something we can live with. the problem is Afghans cannot live with it because they already have a civil war, which probably can become more dangerous and more bloody, but it's already bloody enough. Just go to the countryside in Afghanistan, then you see it. From Kabul, it's really difficult to see. Thank you.
Thank you, Thomas Wuttig, and thanks to everybody who has taken this very short time to put a lot of input in that. I would now give the word to you in the audience. I would always collect a few questions, and please identify yourself, and please also say to whom you direct your question. Malaise? And please also be brief.
Okay. My name is Malaise Daoud, and I come from Afghanistan, but I've been residing in Berlin for the past 6 months now. All my questions, which are three, are directed to Mr. Saleh. The first thing I'd like to mention is your Lebanon scenario. I'd like to know if you also think that that scenario already exists de facto, not only in the Taliban-controlled area, but also in the north and west of the country, where armed forces with foreign support already have the power to decide politically, economically, and socially upon the fate of the people. The second question is the vision, which we all Afghans discuss nowadays, the political philosophy that our military forces should be fighting for does not exist. What do you think that vision should be in your mind? And the third question is, I've resigned 6 jobs in the past 9 years with the Afghan government because of one thing, that we don't have say in the strategically important questions as you raised. You stayed in the government for such a long time. Why? Why didn't you raise your voice? Thank you.
Hello, my name is Kevin Franke. I work at the German Bundestag for Delegate over here. I have 2 questions for Mr. Saleh and then to the other side, to the international community. What is your opinion on the recent, I don't call it lawyer jirga, but jirga, that decided on the proposal Karzai brought in for having American bases in Afghanistan? And the second question would be, what is your opinion, what the Americans would like to do with their bases in Afghanistan? What is their goal there, what they're aiming for? Thank you.
Entschuldigung, hier vorne.
Klaus Wittmann, former general of the Bundeswehr and senior fellow at the Aspen Institute, Germany. I have a simple but difficult question. If we hear about, and they are principally, it goes to everybody on the podium, if we hear about the achievements in Afghanistan, which of those, health, human rights, women rights, schooling and so on, which of those are irreversible? And what would have to happen to make some of those at least irreversible?
Okay. Mr. Saleh, would you start? You have gotten the most questions here.
Let me be very, very frank with you. I am not anti-Pashtunization of Afghan politics. And if we can stabilize the country through Pashtunization of the economy, Pashtunization of the politics, Pashtunization of the culture, that's a good thing. We have lived for centuries together and we have coexisted, complementing each other. But I am fundamentally against Talibanization of the country. And I believe it is very unfair and it is an injustice to my country to label the Pashtuns as Taliban and to say this ethnic group, with all its past and present glories, cannot produce a leader but Mullah Omar. That I find extremely difficult. So Pashtuns finding their due place, overdue place, bigger place in my societies absolutely acceptable. I live in a multi-ethnic street, and my kids speak both languages of Afghanistan, and for the first 4 or 5 years I had put them in Pashto medium school. Why do I say that making the Taliban sound like representatives of the Pashtuns is a Musharraf's strategy? Because he was saying day one, he was saying in October 2001, that Taliban should be representative of the Pashtuns. He communicated that directly to the CIA, to the Pentagon, to the State Department. So why did we fight the Taliban? Because they are a group. It is like to say fighting Al-Qaeda equals fighting the Arabs. It's the same. So if a group kills Afghans, fine. We can accommodate them in our political system because Afghan blood is cheap. But if the same philosophy kills West, then you cannot accommodate them in the political process because they are terrorists. That I don't think is fair to the Afghan people. Your question. When I ask for reform, my brother, I don't ask for a South-centric reform. I ask for reform all over the country. I ask for reform in Mazar, I ask for reform in Kandahar, I ask for reform in Panjshir, and I ask for reform in Kabul. This politics of patronage, the division of resources and distribution of the resources amongst the very few who dominate the ruling clique, is hurting us, all of us, equally. So we all know these big names who have dominated business in Afghanistan, dominated politics in Afghanistan, and dominated governance in Afghanistan. And these big mafia names, in the meantime, every week, receive as their special guest, one of the big Western ambassadors, talking to them. If this scenario continues, it will be warlordism entrenched in 2014, not a new horizon opened up to the Afghan politics. I don't want to name names, but go back to 2009. One name the Americans were resisting too hard not to be included in Karzai's team. Who was he? That same person is spending time with the most senior U.S. officials every day. So, I am not asking for an ethnic reform. I ask for reform all over the country. Now, if we were to trust the figures the Americans release, the latest report I read, the war has costed the United States $526 billion. In addition to that, $79 billion has gone to economic aid for Afghanistan. Of the $79 billion economic aid to Afghanistan, three quarters have gone to the south. Where is the impact? I go back to my colleague's comments. Perhaps three quarters of that has ended up in the hands of the big and corrupt contractors. We don't see the real impact in the daily lives of the people. Now, I have spoken a lot about my resignation. I just want to make it say one thing very. I remain loyal to Afghanistan. I still advocate that the Afghan state be strengthened, as you saw in my presentation. The reason I resigned, it was very clear, many reasons. Primary reason, I saw the masters of the state in the meantime were becoming the spoilers, and I found it difficult to continue. What should be the vision for the Afghan ANSF to fight? They should fight for a clean government, for a clean system which will protect Afghan diversity and pluralism. That's not the case. They are disowned by the very political masters and by the very commander-in-chief for whom they fight. How many times the Afghan politicians have called the Afghan National Army a mercenary force? So why should they fight for such a vision? Therefore, if we want the utility of force to increase, we should praise the force. We should own them. We should dine with them. and we should live with them. That's not the case now.
I think this question of vision, it would also be worth asking you, Shinkai, because the point has been raised also by others here. What should the forces, what should politicians be loyal to? What does the government stand for? And so what kind of vision should there be? Would you mind also saying something about that?
The vision which the politician should stand for the unity among the people, and how we built the country with solidarity. Nobody can build our country, nobody can save and secure country until we accept and create the culture of tolerance and accept everybody as Afghan and work for Afghanistan. That should be the only vision I'm thinking about.
There were two more questions regarding, first of all, the Loya Durga. What is thought about that? And the second, achievements that have been made that will not be sacrificed or behind which we will not fall back. I don't know, Tom Koenis, you've been dealing with that a lot. Will you start, please, answering that?
I will only make one remark to the Loya Durga. I see that the importance of the Loya Durga, particularly to create the constitution, can't be denied. Nevertheless, this Loya Durga is in opposition to the parliament, because I keep asking, if a Loya Durga decides upon a constitution and the constitution creates certain institutions and a parliament has been elected, where is the role of a parliament in a surely very important question for the country? What will be the role of the United Nations, the United States military and their bases? And if there should be a consultation of the public in general, then the president has the institution for that, with which is the parliament. So I understand the Loya Durga principally as in opposition to the parliament, which doesn't agree to certain moves of the president. I would like to answer one question of the general here in front. Throughout the peace processes and throughout the world, this question is being asked: what stays, what remains among the achievements? And the longest lasting achievements are always those achievements in the change of mindset, what happens in the heads of the people. The roads, the physical infrastructure will go to hell very soon. But what we have done and what we have achieved in education, in capacity building, in training, in supporting the Democrats, in supporting the institutions for human rights, that will remain. And certainly, to put it to one point, those proud and efficient and very outspoken female parliamentarians we have in Afghanistan, they will not be silent after whatever development and whatever scenario might happen. And these are the real achievements. Let me add one thing. For that, the advice I would give to the Bonn Conference would always be: support anything which is capacity building, education. That is what is needed and what remains, not the physical infrastructure and not the bases and all that.
Thank you. First Thomas, then Mr. Vendrell, and then Shinkai once again.
Yeah, just a word on this traditional Loya Durga, as it was called. I think it was a contradiction in itself. The government has told the Durga, you can make recommendations and we take the decisions. But actually, from Afghan tradition, Jurgas are decision-making bodies, so I found it manipulative, and according to my Kabul-based colleagues, the discussions in the Loya Durga were astonishingly low level, so to say. This is not how I know Afghanistan, to be frank. It's a hand-picked body, and it has not created, as the peace Durga last year, a national consensus. We have important political actors who opted out of that. It needs more work to constitute a national consensus about those key issues which a Loya Durga should discuss and which are on the agenda in Afghanistan. on the question on irreversibility of achievements in Afghanistan, I think nothing is irreversible in Afghanistan. Unfortunately, it's still too unstable. We see that achievements in education and health are going back, not because no infrastructure has been erected, but people cannot go to clinics anymore. There are no doctors there because they cannot live in dangerous areas. They're still underpaid. Parents opt to take children out of school because it's too dangerous to go there. There are attacks, and some people look at them negatively and stuff like that. What I think, there's one condition how it can be made irreversible, which is bringing down the level of violence. And I think this can only be done through a genuine political process, not just talking to the Taliban. What needs to be done is decrease the level of violence in the rural areas of Afghanistan. That's where most of these things are still very vulnerable. And I want to make one remark, which I forgot when it was my turn. It has to do with this political space and political parties and civil society. Barbara has been talking about civil society. I think I want to use that here to congratulate you and the other foundations who organized this conference, because it was not the intention of the Western governments and of the Afghan governments to have civil society interfering with the so nicely planned Bonn II conference. They wanted to have something in Kabul, they wanted to have something in summer, and it was combined pressure by Afghan civil society itself, who actually started feeling how difficult the situation is and started to getting the act together and tried to speak with one voice, and a couple of people who supported them from the international community. That's very important. Civil society has been, or the international community and the current Afghan government and all Afghan governments which of the last 10 years have tried to use them as fig leaves, and now they're not allowing themselves anymore to be used like that. And I hope that we will hear some dissent around the Bonn II conference, particularly because governments don't want to hear it.
Well, a lot of the questions have been answered by my colleagues, but on the lawyer Girda, I said when I spoke earlier that we needed the search for a genuine political consensus, and I think that speaks for itself. Lawyer Girdas rarely succeed unless they are very carefully prepared, and they should be they should happen after there has been careful consultation with all political groups. It's a little bit like regional conferences and international conferences. They are always a success. The outcome of the Bonn conference, we already know. The outcome of the conference in Istanbul was already known. They are always a success because no one is going to be so unkind as to say to the host that they wasted their money holding the conference. But just as you need, as I said earlier, you need to build first an agreement with each regional country, including, of course, Pakistan and Iran and India and a few others, and then have the regional or the international conference. The same applies to a lawyer Girda. You first need to build the real consensus, and then maybe you can enshrine it in the form of a lawyer Girda. About the gains that are irreversible, I'm not sure. I tend to think, like Thomas, that very few are not irreversible. But there are some new facts. One of the new facts is the growing urbanization of Afghanistan. And it's going to be difficult for the Taliban to try and reverse, it would be difficult for the Taliban to try to impose their, what I might call, fairly primitive Pashtun countryside values on increasingly large cities. Finally, one point to my friend Amrullah Saleh. I don't think I echoed Musharraf's position. I think that, as he himself pointed out, Musharraf is equated the Taliban with the Pashtuns. I never have said that. I think it is an insult to the Pashtuns to equate them with the Taliban. But as Thomas said, when there was less representation politically of Pashtuns at the time, not now, then, It did make that many Pashtuns feel that they were on the losing side, even if they were not necessarily supporting the Taliban.
One thing I want to talk about the Luyu Jirga, that I don't know why everybody take it as a negative approach. It's not having like a Luyu Jirga for some issue which is very important for Afghanistan. I think it was one of the things, I think, a good thing which the government did, besides all the things which unwanted things they are doing, is the Jirga was as a traditional system which Afghan facing problem from family dispute to the national, having such a platform to come together. And it was a good opportunity for Afghans from different level, politicians, parliamentarians, civil society, religious scholars, different groups of people, women and men, all come together. At least there was a 4 days, the people, Afghan people talk about the very important issue, which was how to deal with the political process, there's a peace process in the future, because the previous approach were failed, and also regarding the strategic partnership Americans. It was a good opportunity. It was like opportunity for learning and get aware of the issues. And besides lots of warning, which we got a telephone calls and text message which threatened our life to death if you go to such a gathering, which is a Luyu Jirga. I don't think that the conducting such a Luyu Jirga was ignorance of the parliament. Parliament has a clear responsible authority, and even the president of Afghanistan clearly mentioned about the role of this Jirga and also the final decision which will be made after compromising with the government of America, and the final approval and disapproval will be belong to the parliament of Afghanistan. It wasn't that every approach should be like considered as a negative approach. Thank you.
You see, the something in the negotiations or in the process of negotiations is called moment of ripeness. It's a moment where you think there is nothing you can achieve more than what you can achieve now, then you enter into negotiations. Perhaps NATO has realized that this is it. They cannot achieve a sort of conventional victory, so let's start negotiations. But the thinking on the other side, the perception on the side of the Taliban and Pakistan is, this is minimum they have achieved, they can maximize it. So while they think they can maximize their achievements, we, the Afghan political forces, are weakening the state to appease the enemy. That is what I oppose, not the principle of the negotiations.
Thank you. We take a second round of questions, and there is Sitamas.
Sita Maas, as a private person, I take the liberty to speak out what is in my mind. Coming back to the Luyu Jirga, I refer to the Luyu Jirga, not the previous ones, but to the one we could heard news about during last week. For about 1 week, I listened to the news in the German media, and I became rather angry, because the general impression was that this is a traditional mechanism of the Afghan society, which as such is correct. Only, I think it was Friday evening, finally I heard a comment by Sabina Mattai, and she criticized the composition of the Luyu Jirga. So my question now is, first I would like to ask Thomas Ruttig to give us more information how the delegates have been selected. Then Shinkai, can you again be slightly more critical about the composition, not the traditional mechanism, but I'm specifically referring to the handpick composition. And maybe Amrullah Saleh can also give his presentation on the composition, because I think we got a very wrong impression in the German media. Thank you.
Right there. Yeah, the lady.
Thank you. My name is Amna Khan, and I'm a visiting fellow at the SWP. Just two quick comments and then my question. I agree with Mr. Wendel and Ruting. I think you made some very valid points. I would just like to say that coming from the tribal areas of Pakistan, Pakistan has suffered a lot as well. And I think the region is continuously suffering, and we need to move beyond the blame game. Because the only way we can bring stability is by cooperating. And regarding what President Musharraf said, he was an individual. And I don't think what one individual says stays, because for that matter, many individuals have said many things. I think we need to cooperate. And just one quick point. If supposedly Pakistan, I mean, I agree that yes, in the past, there were people in our administration who used to support the Taliban. But you need to understand the dynamics have changed, and Afghanistan is not the same Afghanistan that it was 10 years ago. And again, if it's such a problem and all the problem is coming from Pakistan, why not fence the border? When we did try to do it and initiate it, it was the Afghans who were against it. So again, I think we need to move beyond confrontation and start working for cooperation. Thank you.
Hier in der vierten Reihe ist noch ein Herr, der sich gemeldet hatte.
My name is Hamidullah, and I'm a student of Master of Public Policy in Erfurt. My question is to the international community, especially to Tom Koenigs. You mentioned about the parliament, to strengthen the parliament in Afghanistan, and I guess this is one of the things, if we can create checks and balances system in democracy so that democracy can function well. I will just give you an example of instances where international community undermines the effort of parliament. I don't want to name the minister, but one time in the first parliament of Afghanistan, they impeached some ministers, and the government of Germany especially kind of criticized the decision of the parliament, and they didn't let that minister to step down. So when there is checks and balances system and there is institution building and the institutions are working, the international community is actually undermining the legitimacy and credibility of these institutions themselves. I also want to refer one question to Mr. Saleh. To give you the scenario of the situation now in the region in Afghanistan, we have Iran, and Pakistan is one of our two of our major neighbors. We do need friendship and coordination and trade with these countries. Now we know that Iran has very bad relation with the US in the West because of the nuclear problem they have over the nuclear issue. If we don't create friends on the other border of our country, we are not sure we can make good friends with Iran, because we have decided we can give a strategic partnership or base to USA, and Iran is obviously opposed to this decision. So how you feel that we, despite being economically dependent on our neighbors, how can we involve ourselves in the blame games and not make friendship based on economic opportunities? Thank you.
Okay. Tom Koenigs, magst du anfangen?
Just one misunderstanding. The last speaker said, rightly, that the international community failed to strengthen the parliamentary institutions which have been elected and created through the Afghan constitution. I see these mistakes, and I don't want to continue with these mistakes. So we have to believe in the parliament. Even in the constitution itself, which is already very president heavy, we should recognize that there should be these checks and balances between parliament and executive, and we should abstain from weakening and do everything that the parliamentarians are successful. I think if one of the goals of international support would be, as principle, the elected bodies of Afghanistan have to be successful. This as an element for the transition, and a result, say, of a conference of Bonn would be already something.
Regarding the jury and the composition, Thomas, you were asked to give some comments, and Shinkai as well. Shinkai, please start. The composition of the jury.
Actually, I'm not supposed to talk about the composition of the Louis jury, what was good, bad, or very much ideal. But at least it was like a platform that everybody from the way they were selecting the people, I'm not talking, but for me it's very much important the content, the issue were discussed and shared with the public. If more than 2,000 people are coming together and talk about the two important issues, that was very much important. And for the information of Thomas Rottinger, let me tell him that every jirga could not make a final decision. We have lots of jirga, we could not come to conclusion and they just leave. But it was clearly mentioned in the beginning in the speech of President Karzai that it's only advising the government for this two issue. What do they think about such issue, but not a decision-making jirga. So at least every like a woman, man, but of course, as a woman, I was not happy. We had women less than 20%. I would prefer to have more women. I'm not talking about the mechanism they called on invite people, but there was a representative from different layer of the society and were representing there and come together and talk about. At least the media, the people on the street, home, everywhere, they were talking about this partnership with America and plus about the peace process. That was important for me as a woman. And also hearing from my own constituency, what do they think about that issue? It was like a good event for us, thank you.
Yeah, I can try to add something. I mean, it's a different thing whether a Loya Jirga comes to a decision or not, but the thing is, it was questioned from the beginning that the Loya Jirga can make its own decision, and it was kind of prescribed by the government. I mean, Afghanistan is not a totalitarian country, so there's always good and good factors, and the same goes for the composition of the Loya Jirga. There was a relatively high degree for Afghan circumstances of central organization of it. The delegates were composed through the ministries and through the provincial governors who are appointees of the government and of the president. So our impression was that to a high degree people were chosen who would not be too negative to the to the position the government would take. And we also know that there were seminars or whatever it was called before to tell the delegates a little bit what the line of the government is so that they hopefully would follow them. Not everyone would have done that. But, I mean, I've seen all Loya Jirgas since 2001. That one was the first one I was not inside. But what I'm hearing is that the discussion was much more lively in the other ones and that I find a little bit astonishing. I'm not saying that it was a complete puppet institution or something like that, but I think it was a little bit too much stage managed for the circumstances in which Afghanistan needs a more lively and controversial debate about things which are really controversial. And there are a few things which are more controversial in Afghanistan than US bases in what form ever, and talking to the Taliban. Yeah. Can I also say something about that question, economic cooperation in the region and friendship and so on? That all sounds very good, but we also have to look, I mean, it's not done in a week or two or in a year or two. When we look at Bonn 1, 2001, all the regional countries were there, Iran, Russia, Pakistan. It was a time when the Americans were still talking to the Iranians. So everyone tried to be constructive in those days, although they had their own interest. I think one of the major features of this process post 2001 was that in the beginning it was at least attempted to be a UN-led, international community-led process, and it became a NATO-led process and became a military-led process within NATO. And that, amongst other things, apart from the Afghan population, which is a different issue, but it also estranged countries like China and Pakistan and Iran and Russia, and they all, and there are circles in those governments who just want to see everyone fail in Afghanistan for no particular reason, except probably some revenge for earlier times. So under these circumstances, and then when we look into the region, we see that all neighboring countries of Afghanistan have bigger problems with other neighbors in Afghanistan. For none of these countries, Afghanistan is the number one problem. So the Pakistanis are busy with the Indians and vice versa, and Uzbekistan is mining its border with Tajikistan, and Afghanistan is of second rank. And those direct bilateral problems are blocking regional cooperation, whether it has to do with Afghanistan or not. It's all very nice, and I like the poem also, which is quoted from Muhammad Iqbal, that Afghanistan's the heart of Asia, and if the heart doesn't beat, then the whole body will be sick. But that's lyrics, I'm sorry. It has nothing to do with politics and with wishful thinking. It will need many more years, and it will need confidence building between the neighboring countries, between the US and the neighboring countries. How can the US be an honest broker? And it tries to play that role in Afghanistan when it has these absolutely unconstructive relations with Iran. I'm not saying that Iran is particularly constructive, but it's always a give and take, and it's not one-sided. And here I think we should not go for these big concepts like the Silk Road, which I also think it's more lyric than realism. It's about this daily work, which is not really good for the media, and you cannot take photos of it. I mean, you need to start working in the bilateral sphere and on smaller things, and not always think you invent one silver bullet and everything, we work up tomorrow and everything's solved.
Since we started a bit late, I will take the freedom to steal some minutes from the break, and that will give us the chance to have another two questions and brief answers on the podium. Okay, please, there in the on the left-hand side from my, here auf der linken Seite in der fünften Reihe. Here, yeah.
Hello everyone, my name is Khaled. I study public policy in Erfurt. I have one question to Ms. Karohel. You, in your presentation, you mentioned, you also said that Taliban are supported by Pakistan and that you also want... like you're in favor of negotiation with them. But don't you think that negotiation with Taliban, they will put also the interests of Pakistan in the table of negotiation, which I don't think can be acceptable to any Afghan? That was my question. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'm also a student in Humboldt University. I don't want to criticize anyone, and also I haven't any question, just I want to add some comments. And I think this is my responsibility as a young generation of Afghans. I should see some things. Now we are discussing some things about Loya Jirga and other things, and at the first I want to appreciate from the good comments, good remarks of everyone, international community politicians, our politicians, and I appreciate all of them. But we know, and nowadays in Afghanistan, discussing about the politics of Afghanistan, each child in the every street, every year can discuss about the reasons, they have some suggestions, this should be the same, this should be the same, and this should be why. But this is not our problem, and we cannot say after 10 years why we are not the same. We know, politically, we know the reasons of these things. But I'm not talking diplomatically, politically. I am talking as a common Afghan, as an ordinary Afghan. Those who have a bad view in the international community, as a student, I cannot say when I'm saying I'm Afghan, everyone, those who are not, start questioning, asking me, hey, what's why? I am a human. I'm not doing the same. But the best thing, and I want to add for international community politicians, for our politicians, we have many problems, I know, but we should concentrate, we should focus deeply on education of children, on education of girls, our mother education. This is so important for us. I hope if the international community, especially if America wanna benevolently help us, just invest in one person, in one boy, in one girl of Afghanistan. Don't invest our military forces, don't invest our streets, roads, and other things. And I hope if they invest the same things, it will be better from taller buildings, it will be better from roads, and we will find
Thank
the security, everything. And I hope everyone should
much.
Discuss about these things.
Agree.
Loya Jirga is not important. This is symbolic, I know.
Thank you very much for your input as well. Is there one brief question maybe to the... Okay, Onike here.
Hello, my name is Ramak Baikar, studying public policy at the Willy Brandt School of Policy in Erfurt. Mr. Thomas just reminded me of the realistic theory. and perhaps in the international relations. I just try to be a bit realistic when it comes to negotiations in the country. I try to draw a table for myself to examine the values, agendas, and the objectives of the parties who are supposed to negotiate on peace in the country. On one side, we have the Taliban with their values of extremism, suicide bombing, and depriving women from their natural rights. On the other side, we have the government of Afghanistan that's working to promote these rights. When it comes to the agenda of these two parties, well, for me, Taliban would have two agendas. One, to fight for an ideology, and second, to fight for political concession. Well, the first...
But could you formulate your question just very briefly, because we're running out of time.
Yes. Just pointing out that the values of these two parties are the values of the government of Afghanistan and the values of Taliban are reconcilable. And
thank you.
Okay, that's it. For the sake of the time. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. We will do a last round through all the participants, and please combine what you want to answer with your final words.
I particularly want to answer the question of Madame from Fatah from tribal areas. Whether it's a coincidence or it is the reality, you are asking the question which the establishment in Islamabad asks us. Well, it's perhaps you are so united in your... When we talk of a vision in which harmony, cooperation, and trade prevails and sidelines politics, in that scenario, you do not need fencing of the border, especially when ethnic groups on both sides speak the same language. So when you raise the question of fencing, it means you don't trust each other. The Germans destroyed the fence which had put them together. Europe has become, and they are cooperating not because their borders are strong, because they are increasingly making their borders porous and less physically controlled. No. What does Pakistan want from us that we cannot give them? We are weak, and weakness does not bring respect or fear. So when we speak to the Pakistanis and put our agenda on the table, they still want to weaken us, so we become minimum in our demands. In reality, if you truly, truly analyze what Pakistanis want from us, they want us to act like a protectorate. This is not a vague statement. I have dealt with ISI for years, and I have visited their headquarters, and they have come to me. I have talked to the politicians in Pakistan. Simply, the military and the establishment mindset in Islamabad is, this nation owes us a lot, and we have to dictate political terms there. Now, for cooperation to prevail, there must be respect, mutual respect. When we exhibit mutual respect, they don't reciprocate it because they consider we are weak. On the other issue that my friend, the student Hamidullah raised, the thing is, this policy that I am friendly with everyone and I am anti-everyone in the region is now clearly backfiring. We cannot be a neutral country. The policy of neutrality has not brought glory to Afghanistan. It is a very critical and sensitive issue, but we have to side with someone. So President Karzai's speech in the Jirga, that he's equally thankful to Iran for giving him a penny, and he is thankful to the United States for giving him billions, and he is thankful to India for being such a generous friend, and he is thankful to Pakistan for sending bombs. This is not going to last very long. We have to engender a vision. and stick to it. This blurred policy is not going to last. So the solution is for us, the Afghans, to strengthen ourselves and have a state functioning beyond 2014.
Regarding question how we can negotiate with the Taliban, even you are against women's rights. I think I have to answer that we have a two neighbors. We cannot stay, and also we cannot stay with them, and we cannot stay without them. It's whether we want or not, they are there. But unfortunately, they're always think how to keep destabilize Afghanistan for their own interest, rather than to think that stable Afghanistan will benefit them more than destabilize Afghanistan. Negotiation with the Taliban, see, we cannot eliminate all these people. And also they have supporters. We not only Pakistan, but also Iran, even they do not have common language and common belief and religious sect, but still they are supporting financially. So they are the reality, they are existing there. Those, if you provide such an opportunity, those who want to change their mind and come, and because some of the Taliban, because of the bad governance, because of lack of job opportunity or quality services in the ground, or maybe another problem with security problem with the government, they left Afghanistan, and they, just to survive, they have no other option just to stay with the Taliban. And they are using against the stability of Afghanistan. So when there is a reality, for how long more we can fight? As Mr. Saleh said, bringing more troops also did not help if we withdraw the international troops, and also we do not have the same qualified security sector to fight. For how long we can continue? So the only way, I think, is to negotiate with the Taliban, but not to cross certain limit or like a line that if they want to compromise based on like a human rights or women's rights or those issues. But those who want to come back, we should provide such opportunity and improve our governance so they can come and to reduce the threat for the stability of Afghanistan. As a woman, and of course, I don't want to go back to my previous life, and I want to fully enjoy my freedom and my basic human rights. So it doesn't mean that as a woman, I want to tolerate all extremists, but they are a tool for others to be used against Afghanistan.
I think those who have been participants or observer of peace negotiations or the results know that if you start from the extreme, you'll never end. In all countries, people of very different values live together and find a type of understanding. And we have to bring down the question of negotiation with the Taliban to the real things, which are to be negotiated. And in a talk on Afghanistan with experts from different countries of the region, we have listed what could be elements of negotiations. Certainly an end of fighting in the areas where there is fighting. This is of the interest of the Taliban too. They cannot go on fighting war another 30 years. The second is withdrawal of the US forces. There is movement on that front. Then the question of the blacklist. This has to be a blacklist. This has to be negotiable, because otherwise you'll never have peace. The release of the prisoners in Guantanamo. Very good question. Very good point to negotiate. All the Taliban prisoners in Afghanistan. Even that could be an element of negotiation. Except Taliban as a political movement, not a violent military, but a political movement. These are questions. And then we have the big, big value question, which is the Sharia. Even there is a compromise possible, because in the actual constitution of Afghanistan, we have a paragraph on Sharia, which is very disputed. Nevertheless, the actual constitutions. And there are a lot of countries which have this Sharia paraf and adhere to human rights. So don't say there is no way to negotiation. There is no way to continuing the war. Yes, we have experienced that for 10, 15 years. So let's stick to the realities and not speak about the big, big, big values and are you going to compromise and are you start with red lines. We have to start with a ceasefire.
Well, first, I think one talks and negotiates with one's enemies, not with one's friends. And the reason to negotiate is precisely because one doesn't share the same views. Now, you say that the Taliban will fight for their ideology. I hope the government will also fight for its ideology as well. But inevitably, that's why you need a third party to try and see if it's possible to reconcile. During the Cold War, it seemed impossible to reconcile Marxist movements with governments. And yet it turned out to be possible, for example, in various countries in Central America. Second, about the strategic partnership, I can understand, I think that the strategic partnership with the US is at the moment an insurance for Afghanistan. At the same time, I also think that in the process of an overall settlement, this strategic partnership may have to be abandoned. That I do not entirely agree with Amrullah Saleh when he says that neutrality brought Afghanistan no respect. I think Afghanistan was a highly valued member of the international community up to 1978, and partly because it was seen as a neutral country. Now, one can't choose where one lives. And the fact remains that one is surrounded by countries that have major interests, many of them unacceptable interests, on Afghanistan. American bases will make it, if a settlement were possible, I'm only talking, American bases will make it very difficult to reach an understanding with the Taliban, or indeed to have Pakistan, Iran in particular, and possibly even China and Russia, feeling very comfortable. I'm not saying at this point, but there may be a time when an international guaranteed non-alignment of Afghanistan may well be the solution. Now, this is not the moment. But I have to simply remind people that Switzerland, Austria were neutral. They became neutral at the moment when it was unavoidable. Their neutrality has now changed. And in many ways, they have a more independent foreign policy than the members of the EU. So I think that we have to bear this in mind, because otherwise I don't see how a settlement is going to be possible.
Yeah, building on what has been said, in the moment, indeed, the positions of the Kabul government and the Taliban are far apart, and I wish the government had as strong an ideology as the Taliban have, so that they know what to defend except for business models to what it is very often tending. Kabul Bank, someone says. Exactly because of that, it's necessary that we see that a political solution will not come from talks between the current Kabul government and the Taliban. It will only come to a political solution which is viable if other forces are involved, and that's political forces and social forces in Afghanistan. These are those people who usually are not at the, the levers of power. So that process needs to be open. That's, of course, probably sounds also a little bit utopian, but I believe that there's no way around it. It needs to be started now because it has not been started before. And there we can probably build on the Loya Jirga and on other mechanisms in Afghanistan. What I think is needed is a continuous process of discussions amongst people in Afghanistan who are engaged in political issues to come to an agenda about which then talks will be held. On the Taliban side, as I said before, I mean, it always sounds like a defense, but it is not a defense of the Taliban. But it doesn't help to demonize them and only see them as throat cutters. There are people who have genuine motives for which they have joined the Taliban very much in the beginning in 2003, 4, 5. It has become more ideological now and has become more difficult to talk to them. Also because a lot of those people, the Americans knew and we knew, have been killed by now through this absolutely unacceptable kill and capture thing, which has been also replicated, we should not forget that, by the Taliban. They were killing also a lot of people. But also not everyone who's killed in Afghanistan is killed by the Taliban. There are also internal things. So we really need to be a little bit more specific. And we also need to look into what Taliban are really doing. I mean, whether we want to recognize that or not, there are large areas of Afghanistan which are virtually controlled by the Taliban. And over there, in some of those areas, something like governance is going on. They have people with whom NGOs have to register because they play a shadow government and want to assert this role. And they also allow, in some areas, girls' schools. In which areas do they allow that? Where the population goes to them and pressures them to the point that they allow it. Because very often when you take over an area, they close down everything what looks like a school. And then some populations are courageous and go and pressure them, and it works. We are just doing a study about that, which will be hopefully out in a few weeks, about Taliban education policy. And what the people who are doing that for us have found out, yes, they have a policy, which is also not something which we can embrace, because it's mainly like in those areas which they control, and that's quite a lot. They allow schools where they're not challenged. They attack schools very often in areas which are competed, because schools then are seen as government institutions, which is undefendable. But what does that whole tell us? First, we need an analysis of what they want, what they're doing, and not be just influenced by newspaper headlines. And then also talk with them about that without the demonization, and also force them to make concessions. And it can start with schooling and access to health and not killing civilians and not killing civilian government employees and all these things. I mean, but that needs to be brought into a process, and this is not where it is yet. Because as far as what we know about the talks which have been held between the US and the Americans, they were talking to each other, but they were not understanding each other. The Americans were talking about that one US soldier has been captured by the Haqqani people in southeastern Afghanistan, and the Taliban wanted to talk about the withdrawal. And then we were looking at each other and saying, but this is not important for us. What we also need to understand is that the other side's issues need to be taken as important, even if we find it ridiculous. That's, I think, how negotiations are done.
Thank you very much, everybody. Vielen Dank. Damit endet dieses spannende Panel. Ich möchte nur noch einmal sagen, nutzen Sie die Möglichkeit, mit den Referenten und allen anwesenden Gästen auch in der Pause zu sprechen. Und um 12 geht es weiter mit dem Programm. Es geht um Medien in Afghanistan, und bitte finden Sie sich dann auch wieder hier ein. Dankeschön.